Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Yalmaz Siddiqui, Senior Director of Environmental Strategy for Office Depot.
Good morning. Thank you very much. First, I'd like to start by dispensing with a truth. Much like Mayor Michael Nutter last night admitted, acknowledged, that you weren't here, you weren't there at the closing plenary to hear from Michael Nutter, you were there to hear from Hillary Clinton. I acknowledge that you are not here to hear from Yalmaz Siddiqui, Senior Director of Environmental Strategy at Office Depot. You are here to hear Nate Silver. But please humor me for perhaps 10 minutes as I try to do an atypical sponsor speech and perhaps try and add a little value to your lives. I'm going to do many things in this short 10 minutes. I'm going to tell you a story. I'm going to present a case study. I'm going to give someone an award. I'm going to present a problem and a solution. That's a lot of things in 10 minutes, but I will try. Here's the story. 2009, Greenbuild, Phoenix. I'm standing at the Office Depot booth, and this gentleman walks up to me and says, "What are you doing here?" Kind of an aggressive question. And took me aback a bit. What took me aback even further was the person who asked me this question was none other than David Gottfried. Now, some of you may know that David Gottfried is the founder of the U.S. Green Building Council, and I was lucky enough to recognize him because I had just finished his book 3 weeks before for Greenbuild Phoenix. So, as the founder of a movement as significant as U.S. Green Building Council asks you, "What are you doing here?" you clearly go inside and say, you know, what are we doing here? Have we crashed the party? Are we not allowed in this exclusive building world? Or, you know, are we confused? Did we ship the wrong booth? So, I managed to persuade David, I think. I've become closer to David, and I persuaded him at that occasion and subsequently that the reason Office Depot is at Greenbuild is because we enable greener purchasing for everything inside a green building, from furniture to lighting to cleaning to paper, etc. Thank you. And unbeknownst to many, we also do quite a lot of good green stuff in terms of 3 years, consecutive years of number one ranking as the greenest large retailer in America by Newsweek in the green rankings. 2 million plus square feet of LEED certified buildings across America. And 43% carbon reduction over the last 10 years while our building stock increased slightly. We want to share these sorts of details with an audience that is interested, has a propensity for environmental matters, and clearly you are such an audience. But I'm not here, as I said, to express a typical sponsor presentation about us. I'm here to express a shared problem. And that problem is this. There is $15 trillion of institutional buying power in the United States. That's a combination of B2G, business to government, and B2B intermediate consumption, meaning businesses selling to businesses. And there is 8% of that institutional buying power that's deeply affected by the industry you are in, construction and real estate, about 8%. What's fantastic about the fact that USGBC exists and is able to influence not just the construction and real estate industry, but all the other sectors, as the tone of green is shared across the others, but that you have done a phenomenal job making a transformation in the building sector and many others. Now, how have you done so? You've done so because you have an organization. There is a definition of green building. There is a rating system, a guidebook, an accreditation program that many of you may be accredited to, Lead AP. There is a major expo that we just completed here. And there's a rich data set that shows, before the Green Building Council existed, what was the aggregate environmental impact of buildings and how you've reduced those impacts with changes to the way buildings are made. And in a nutshell, the reason USGBC has been so effective is that there is a widely accepted methodology for green building. Let's look at the rest of the institutional buying power. That 92% of the economy that USGBC might be indirectly influencing, but really, there is no organization that has developed a single definition for greener purchasing or greener organization writ large. There are many definitions of greener purchasing or greener product. There is no rating system that would take an institutional buyer from no clarity to full clarity about how to do greener purchasing. There's no accreditation for purchasers. There's no major expo where the world of greener purchasing comes together. And subsequently, there is a limited data set to express what the aggregate impact of purchasing was in the past and what the aggregate impact of purchasing is in the future based on this organization. In a nutshell, there is no widely accepted methodology for greener purchasing. Now, in that vacuum, Office Depot has stepped as one player to try and create our own solution to the question that we get asked many times by institutional customers of ours, how to green their purchasing. And our methodology is really encapsulated in what we call a greener purchasing program that has five basic elements. Analyze spend, define priorities, switch to greener, measure results in terms of economic and environmental gains, and recognize leadership. And let me just illustrate a couple of these stages. So the first stage, analyze spend. So we have a tool called the Green Business Review where we will express by product category how green an organization's purchasing is, based on our definitions, but because there's a lack of a universal definition of green cleaning and break room, green paper, green ink and toner, etc. This is something we provide to our business-to-business customers who are interested on a quarterly basis. And we also allow them to compare themselves to their industry average, their sector, in the two pie charts. Now, we acknowledge that we have invented that definition, and we do so in many categories where there is no universal definition of greener. We use a set shades of green-based logic, as you can see in the report. You can see light, no green, yellow, mid-green, and dark green. And we've done so by tagging thousands of products with attributes and a rating system that we've developed. Incandescent light would be not green, halogen would be light green, CFL would be mid-green, LED would be dark green because it's the most efficient. SFI certified paper, you're familiar with this topic, we would characterize as meets industry environmental norms. FSC would be light green, 30% recycled would be mid-green, and 100% recycled would be dark green. And a pretty credible entity such as FSC has put on their homepage that we've announced landmark paper purchasing policy essentially based on that shades of green rating system, and they like it, FSC likes it, we believe there's some value to this approach. And before I get to the wider solution of, you know, it's great that Office Depot is trying to lead in this space and bring clarity to a complex situation, but it really is suboptimal that we're doing that ourselves. Because, we're just adding in some ways to the noise in that we're creating our own definition, our own approach, and our own reporting system, and it isn't necessarily a multi-stakeholder approach that solves the problem. But I want to give... I told you in the methodology that we have recognition as one part of the equation, and we believe that's a very important part of encouraging greener behavior. And I want to give an award to an institution that happens to be based in Pennsylvania, in Philadelphia, who happens to have worked with us over many years to green their purchasing. And USGBC was kind enough to allow us to use this platform to present an award to an organization that you will know. This is a Leadership in Greener Purchasing Award, and it's particularly for the work that this institution did with us on greener purchasing analysis, not just at the organizational level, but we can tell at the person level who is buying green and not buying green in that institution. John Smith, in this example, is buying a lot of mid-green products based on our rating system, a little bit of light green, and not a lot of not green. Jerry Rogers, in this example, this is fake data, by the way. Jerry and John do not exist. Jerry, all his spend has no environmental attributes or eco-labels. So what's powerful about this sort of analysis is an institution can drive their nudges to the people they need to nudge the most. And so whereas it was very, very difficult for us to create this sort of data set and deliver the reports that this organization wanted, we're very happy that they pushed us. And I would like them to stand. University of Pennsylvania, Colleen Reardon, Mark Mills. And Brent Friedman, and I would invite them up to the stage, but for they have a large leap, that wouldn't be very good. What's also interesting about University of Pennsylvania is they're actually moving from just environmentally preferable purchasing to sustainable purchasing, in that they're not only focused on greener attributes, but all of their purchasing from Office Depot comes through a minority-owned vendor, and they've negotiated a very good deal. So it's economically preferable, environmentally preferable, and socially preferable, sustainable. So let me close. Let me close with our proposed wider solution. Office Depot has helped create an entity called the Sustainable Purchasing Leadership Council, and this is the question this entity is asking. Could we collaborate to launch a shared program for guiding, measuring, and recognizing leadership in sustainable purchasing? Hopefully that vision is relatable, because it was inspired by USGBC, whose vision is to guide, measure, and recognize leadership in greener building. And you might have heard of this entity for the first time. What I will tell you is there are a lot of organizations, including the state of California, the state of Michigan, the city of Portland, city of San Francisco, FedEx, Office Depot, Ernst & Young, Lockheed Martin, a lot of entities that control a lot of purchasing power are involved in this effort already. And I'd like to close now with my three requests and one favor. The first request is please learn about this nascent effort. And consider joining if you believe you can add value to supplement your efforts in terms of adding value to the U.S. Green Building Council and the green building movement. So please help us, purchasingcouncil.org, to learn about this effort. Number two, one of the participants in the Sustainable Purchasing Leadership Council is Alison Kinn-Bennett. She's one of the senior folks in EPA trying to move EPA and others to greater clarity on credible eco-labels and standards, and they just yesterday put out a request for input on eco-labels and standards for environmental preferable purchasing. So I would recommend, or I'd ask, that you go to epa.gov, this website, and give your input. This is the audience that perhaps has most knowledge about credible eco-labels and standards, so please provide that input. Thirdly, I'd request that you learn a little bit more about Office Depot at officedepotcitizenship.com. I think you might be very surprised at the depth of our program. And my favor, I acknowledge that I'm about to give my email address to 25,000 people. But if you like what you read on officedepotcitizenship.com and you are a large organization in North America who want help with a green purchasing program and like our methodology, please email me directly. Or if you're not, if you don't meet those criteria, please follow me on Twitter. And with that, I'm past my time. I just want to say thank you very much to USGBC, Thank you all for your passion and interest in driving transformation in the building sector and in the world. And with that, I'll pass on to the next speaker. Thank you very much.
Welcome, I'm Roger Platt, and I oversee the troublemaking activities of the U.S. Green Building Council in this country and around the world. Thank you for joining us, thank you, and welcome to the closing plenary of Greenbuild 2013. Over this week, you have been here. You've been here with Cameron Sinclair, with Ed Masria, with David Gottfried, Mayor Nutter, Majora Carter, Rachel Gutter, Scott Horst, and Rick Fedrizzi, and Hillary Rodham Clinton. Yes, we're here for one simple reason. We're here to change the world. We need a voice as large and eloquent as Greenbuild to do that, a unified voice, a voice that will speak truth to power. Join us in creating that voice. And let me be clear, I need all of you, and I mean all of you, to join the growing local, national, and international network of advocates and of troublemakers, those willing to be in the face of the purveyors of popular wisdom and to confront them with a simple message that change is always disruptive. Hillary Clinton herself, when asked by Rick last night, said, asked by Rick about what's the next thing we need to do, said, you need to combine your voices. She said specifically, USGBC has to combine its voices not to become a political vehicle, but to ensure that when political discussions are had, your views are fully considered. So the decision makers, the people who are the influence, the people who influence the decisions here in this country and around the world, they're tired of hearing from me and my team, and I can tell you that I am hoarse talking to them. And I will continue to talk to them. I will continue to talk to them until they pull my troublemaker sword from my cold, dead hands. But now they need to hear from you, because you tell this story better than anybody. And anybody who's been here at Greenbuild knows that what it means to tell the story at a green build level of texture and scale is extraordinary. And it's extraordinary in part because of all the new blood, the fresh faces, the new perspectives that we bring here every single year. And just let me tell you about some of that. Students, emerging professionals, many coming to green build for the very first time, and many coming to green build all the way from Washington, D.C. on bicycles. Stopping along the way to talk to students and schools to tell them that where they learn matters. And what I particularly loved in terms of a fresh new group of unexpected Greenbuild fans, the 70,000 screaming Eagle fans who got suddenly schooled on the ways of green buildings by Rick Fedrizzi at the beginning of the game. And everything became so topsy-turvy, the world so crazy, that Kimberly Lewis, a diehard Redskins fan, was wearing a frigging Eagles jersey. For fresh faces. Majora Carter brought community activists from the South Bronx, articulating ways to find common ground in the development of sustainable cities. And leaders from the rural heartland of this country, the mayor of Greensburg, Kansas, again schooling us on how to create out of the rubble of the worst tornadoes this country has ever seen, a city that has more platinum buildings per capita than any city in the world. One platinum building for every 250 citizens of Greensburg, Kansas. New faces, priests and rabbis, people representing faith traditions and faith organizations, faith-based organizations representing more religions than I knew existed in the world, all focused on one common, deep, deep commitment to protect God's creation. They are here. And in addition to the fresh faces, there are the fresh ideas, the innovators, and innovation at Greenbuild. Intel walked away with the Ray Anderson-inspired Radical Industrialism Award. Intel? Yeah, they're the largest buyer of green power in the United States. Innovation. Scott Horst's debut of the dynamic plaque at the Master Session. A friend of mine visited it and said it was like being at the Oscars. There were lights flashing, paparazzi trying to take pictures of his slides as though it was the fresh new Hollywood star. I mean, that is exciting, and that's very much the flavor of this. But I heard about something later that I just am still getting my head around. And I'm wondering if I've got this right. The Underwriters Laboratory, UL, announced an exclusive partnership with us centered on product transparency in building materials to make sure that people understand the health and safety considerations of the materials they buy, of the buildings they occupy. And I still am getting my head around this. Did the Goliath of the green building certification world just marry up with the behemoth of third-party certification of everything else in the world? Katie, bar the door. It's really happening. And so what do these folks have in common? And what do they have in common with Rick, David Gottfried, Mike Italiano, the original troublemakers? They knew, and they know, that being troublemakers is not just about coming up with new ideas and new answers. It's about asking fundamentally different questions. And here I want to quote from Robert Kennedy, if I can get through the quote, from Robert Kennedy, who 50 years ago, 50 years ago today, his brother was taken from us. And what he said was, there are those who look at things the way they are and ask why. I dream of things that never were, and I ask, why not? That's who we are. That's who you are. We're not losing any time in asking too many whys. We're simply rolling up our sleeves and saying, why not? This is one of the things I love about this movement and about this business and about this industry. It's all the same. It's an industry ready to change the world. And I want to say just one more time, join us. Change the world. Now, the philosophy behind LEED 4 is that sustainability is a journey. It's continuing progress, but it's also a journey along the way. There are people that you help, people that you learn from. And I want to introduce over the course of the next hour or so, some spectacular people that are part of that journey. The first is the president's guy for green buildings. And that's the HUD secretary. And just to give you the flavor of this guy's arc of his remarkable career, when Mayor Bloomberg needed someone to oversee New York City's 165,000 affordable homes and to pack his mission with passion and with a focus on sustainability, he called on Sean Donovan. When President Obama needed someone to lead the fight nationally for safe, decent, affordable, sustainable housing, he called on Sean Donovan. And in the aftermath of Sandy, when President Obama was figuring out who would best address building better, resiliency in the face of that terrible tragedy, he called on Sean Donovan. And when the green building movement needed a member of the president's team to really focus on green buildings, we called on Sean Donovan. And today at Greenbuild, we call on Sean Donovan again to tell us about, with all the passion and all of the compassion that he has, tell us about green buildings, green homes, and resilient communities. Sean Donovan.
Roger, thank you for that kind introduction. I love being introduced as the president's guy on this stuff. And I want to just thank the Green Building Council for two decades of leadership in transforming industries and communities all over this country. I also want to say thank you to every one of you that's in the audience today. My former colleague, Secretary Clinton, reminded us last night that the work that you do as architects, entrepreneurs, scientists, developers, and in so many other ways is leading to healthier economies, healthier families, and a healthier planet. Now, I can't claim to have greened the White House, but I will tell you that as we are here today gathering, there is a $30 million renovation project going on at the HUD headquarters, and it's not costing taxpayers a dime. Now, any of you, how many of you have ever visited the HUD building? More than I would have expected. Well, you know that it's one of the best-known brutalist buildings in the country. You might not know that my predecessor, Jack Kemp, once described it as 10 floors of basement. But I would invite you all back to the HUD building and maybe go see the Green White House as well. And what you'll see is an old vision of what a workspace would look like, should look like, being transformed into a modern, healthy, light-filled, and environmentally friendly building. And it's not costing us a dime because we're using innovative techniques that take that energy savings we're getting and plow them right back into the building. So I'm practicing this in my home as well, just as you all are, and I couldn't be more pleased to be here this morning to talk about how we build on the remarkable progress that you all are making. Now, I don't need to remind you that we gather today at an important moment for our communities. And there's been a lot of discussion here about the way that we've got to act now to combat climate change and prepare our communities for tomorrow. And I know that you all are completely committed to this. But I know you also know that our president, President Obama, is as well. Just think back to his second inaugural address. He said, quote, "We must respond to the threat of climate change, knowing that failure to do so would betray our children and future generations." And let's just think about what we've already accomplished. Under his leadership, the U.S. generates more renewable energy than ever. We've doubled our use of wind, solar, and geothermal. We've raised fuel standards so that by the middle of the next decade, cars will get double the the mileage per gallon of gas. And in my own department, which is charged with building decent and suitable affordable housing and a decent and suitable living environment for every American, we've worked tirelessly to advance this agenda. We partnered with the U.S. Department of Transportation and the Environmental Protection Agency to create the Partnership for Sustainable Communities. And in just a few short years, we've provided planning grants and assistance to communities that are home to nearly half of the American people. Almost 150 million people live in communities that are now part of the Sustainable Communities movement. And what does that mean? That means those communities are tying together their housing, transportation, economic development, and energy goals in new and creative ways. So if you look at what we've already accomplished, the work that we're doing, it is making a real difference. And all of this is in the face of loud voices of opposition. We've brought the U.S. to a place where our carbon emissions are at the lowest level in two decades. And despite the naysayers, we've been reducing our carbon footprint while the U.S. economy is growing. Businesses have created nearly 8 million new jobs over the last 44 months, proving that those who say helping the environment hurts the economy are presenting a false choice. As you show every day, we can do both. And that's why the administration's committed to working with the green building industry to fulfill the goals of the president's new climate action plan. Released in June, the plan represents the most aggressive initiative ever taken by a U.S. president to address climate change. And today I want to highlight our efforts towards two of the critical goals of that plan. First, to drastically reduce carbon emissions to reverse climate change. And two, to protect our communities from the threats climate change already poses to us all. So let me start with resiliency. Last month marked the one-year anniversary of Hurricane Sandy, the superstorm that devastated the Northeast region here in the U.S. And I will say it was a particularly painful episode for me. I'm a native New Yorker, and within just a few blocks from where I lived in Brooklyn, I have friends who lost their homes, their businesses. A close friend lost his daughter to the storm. And those stories were replicated all across the most important economic region in our country. 650,000 homes damaged or destroyed. $65 billion in damage and economic loss. More than 9 million customers lost power. I was in the region just a couple days after the storm hit, and it was absolutely clear that the road to recovery was going to be a long and painful one. So obviously, when the president asked me to chair the Hurricane Sandy Task Force, to rebuild my home city and region, of course, I could say nothing but yes. But in addition to the immediate assistance that those families, those communities needed, he also said to me, Sean, we have to rebuild this region smarter and stronger for those storms that seem to be coming every few years now. I urge you to go to HUD's website. Our rebuilding strategy. There are some innovative, I would say even remarkable, ideas. But first and foremost, we began with something that the president has always believed, that when it comes to our environment, we need to put science first. That's why the task force partnered with the best scientists across the federal government and outside of government to develop recommendations that give local governments, businesses, and citizens the tools they need for the future. We designed a sea level rise tool that allows users to go to the web, click on a map, and see projections of rising sea levels for their street, for their community, as far as 100 years into the future. It helps policymakers plan for the future. It helps homeowners prepare for the future. And it also helps businesses build for the future. As a CEO of a major utility in the region said to me right after the storm, "Sean, just tell me how high to build." And this tool will help them do just that. So with this knowledge in hand, communities can take the necessary measures with partners like you to protect themselves from future floods. But we also had to take responsibility in the federal government for our own investments. And so, for the first time in history, we required every single dollar of the $50 billion Sandy supplemental package that was going into significant rebuilding to not only build for current flood risks, but future flood risks as well. And in fact, in the President's Climate Action Plan, he committed to using this approach nationally, taking future flood risk into account with all of our infrastructure investments. And HUD is already helping so many communities around the country integrate climate adaptation into their own plans. In Mississippi, on the Gulf Coast, HUD grants have funded an assessment of the shoreline to determine the areas at highest risk of natural disaster, fundamentally changing how they execute projects like housing, housing for the elderly, or new shopping districts. When regional development keeps resilience as a guiding principle, communities all across the nation stand to be stronger and more successful. Communities also stand stronger when they incorporate the most innovative ideas from around the world. That's why we've launched Rebuild by Design, a groundbreaking competition to develop innovative projects that protect and enhance Sandy-affected communities. We launched this effort because great challenges often inspire disruptive change, groundbreaking solutions. And as we look to the future, we want to maximize our rebuilding efforts by attracting the best thinking, not just from across the U.S., but across the globe. So we put out an international call for ideas, and the response we got was overwhelming. Almost 150 teams from more than 40 countries answered the call, all presenting remarkably imaginative ideas, ranging from infrastructure to green spaces to brand new technology no one's ever seen. And as we've evaluated them, I want to be very clear. We're not just looking for creative abstract concepts. This is not just another beauty contest. We wanted ideas that we could implement and fund with billions of dollars of federal investment so that they can strengthen our communities. After an intensive judging process, we just announced the final 10 proposals, all with the potential to change how building is done in cities and along shores across the globe. Right now, design teams are meeting with leaders on the ground to determine how these proposals can and should be implemented. And we ask that you serve as a resource for them. Their innovative ideas combined with your expertise is a powerful combination. This work will save lives. It'll protect communities. So I ask you to connect with this effort by going to rebuildbydesign.org. And in doing this work, we know that we can change the future of this region, but also of places all around the world, the billions of people that live in cities and places at risk from our rising sea levels. With these and other efforts, the Obama administration's basic message is this. Climate change is real, and it's already putting our communities at grave risk. Resilience should be a part of all community planning. Every time we plan a sidewalk or a park, we must think about resilience. That we're open to the best ideas from around the world to make this development safer and smarter. And we want to work with you, the green building community, to shape more resilient futures. Now, we also want to work as we're protecting our communities from the effects that climate change is already having. We also need to work with you to reverse these terrible trends. One area that obviously requires a lot of attention is our residential sector. From 1950 to 2009, the amount of carbon dioxide emissions associated with residential use more than tripled. And as I said earlier, during the president's time in office, we've already made some great strides in reducing our footprint. But we know there's still a long way to go. The residential sector contributes a fifth of our energy consumption and our associated emissions in the United States. And we've got to move the needle on this problem if we're going to tackle climate change. To meet the challenge, our Office of Sustainable Housing and Communities has made a pretty remarkable commitment to greening American homes. We've already reached, with our partners at the Department of Energy, 1.4 million homes over the last 4 years. We've worked with the El Paso Housing Authority in Texas to complete the first ever net zero LEED Platinum public housing development in the country. We joined with the Denver Housing Authority. That's right. We joined with the Denver Housing Authority in Colorado on an ambitious 2.3 megawatt renewable energy project that installed 10,000 solar panels across nearly 400 rooftops. In total, we're changing the face of affordable housing in America as it relates to energy. To build on this work, we've launched two initiatives that I need you to be part of. They're designed to decrease waste and increase use of renewable energy. The first is our Better Buildings Challenge. Launched in 2011, this challenge called on commercial and industrial buildings to become 20% more energy efficient by 2020. And the response has been overwhelming. So in June, as part of the Climate Action Plan, and in partnership with the Department of Energy, we extended this challenge to the multifamily sector, asking multifamily owners to commit to a 20% portfolio-wide energy reduction over the next decade. This is an enormous opportunity, an opportunity for owners to reduce costs, an opportunity to support the innovative industries of the future and create good jobs, and an opportunity to shape healthier neighborhoods, especially in vulnerable communities that are more likely to be affected by asthma and other medical conditions. Partners across the nation have recognized the opportunity and begun to seize it. In just a few short months, we already have commitments from multifamily owners representing more than 200,000 apartments, including some of the largest affordable housing and market rate developers in the country. It's a good start, but we won't be satisfied until every eligible owner takes part. So that's where you come in. Owners, utilities, financial entities, anyone here today, I ask you to join us. Doing so will be good for all our families and their futures. And I look forward to working with you to get remarkable progress in cutting our energy waste. But I also want to work with you to increase the use of renewable energy. For the first time, as part of the President's Climate Action Plan, we are setting a renewable energy target for affordable housing across the country. Our focus, and I think rightly so, over the past few years has been on efficiency and conservation. But now we have to build on that foundation by focusing on scaling up solar and other renewables. Specifically, we want to more than triple on-site renewable energy in federally assisted housing to 100 megawatts by the year 2020. It represents an enormous opportunity. That's right. We want to see more successes like the Hispanic Housing Development Corporation's Las Moradas affordable housing property in Chicago. As one of our Energy Innovation Fund grantees, they recently closed on a multi-million dollar New Markets Tax Credit project and leveraged utility incentives to finance solar for their rooftops. As a result, they've already seen a 25% reduction in electricity use and are saving thousands and thousands of dollars every year. So just imagine the potential of on-site renewables if it reached over 5 million units of federally assisted housing in this country. We can and we must reach this goal. In fact, we see it as a key component of building a more economically and environmentally resilient future. Some people say, well, we can't do this with affordable housing. It's too expensive, particularly at a time of limited federal resources. Well, I'd say to you, we can't afford not to do this. And I want to thank the U.S. Green Building Council for their support and their leadership on these efforts. Through the Green Building Information Gateway, they've created a place where owners, investors, and other stakeholders can come together to connect, accelerate the use of on-site renewables, and reach this new federal target. But to complete this mission and support low-carbon, resilient communities, we're going to need everyone here today to participate. It's going to take owners, installers, manufacturers, municipalities, an even broader array of partners to make these initiatives a success. So I ask for your help. Bounded by shared interests and goals, together we can make a difference for both the health and the wealth of our communities. Let's fight for them together. So as I close my remarks, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that we come together today as the world marks the 50th anniversary of the passing of President John F. Kennedy. It's obviously a time to look back, to honor his life and legacy. And on a personal note, I'd say I literally would not be standing here today if it wasn't for his service. He was the one who first proposed the creation of an agency focused on our housing and our communities in a State of the Union address where he committed to the goal of creating a suitable environment for every family. And in the larger picture, as I was thinking about what to say to you today, I thought back to his famous speech at American University, where he sent a message to the world about his strategy for peace. It took place in the Cold War era, a time full of conflict and uncertainty between international parties. Sound familiar? But rather than focus on disagreements, he chose to remind the global community of all that it had in common. He said that, quote, "In the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air, we all cherish our children's future, and we all are mortal." Here we are 50 years later, and those words couldn't be more true. And it's those sentiments that have brought every one of you here today, representing roughly 90 countries across the globe. We all want better for the next generation. We all want to expand opportunity. We all want stronger communities. And we all want a healthier planet. By working together, we can advance these goals. The only question is if we, as a global community, have the commitment and the will to do it. So what's the answer to that? Yes, we do. I know this because you stood up against some very loud voices of opposition to our work. I know this because you've demonstrated by innovating in ways that are both benefiting bottom lines and the common good. It's why I've been proud to work with so many of you to advance this president's agenda. I look forward to doing even more of that in the years to come. So let's stand up for our future. Let's prepare every community for the risks of extreme weather. Let's cut energy waste in half. And let's double renewable energy once again. Let's create an environmentally and economically resilient future for this small planet that we all inhabit. Thank you.
I told you I would be introducing you to some remarkable people, and Donovan just hit it out of the park. I was, again, scratching my head and trying to think, how many new ways can new faces work with us? And if I was scribbling down this correctly, HUD is getting deep into now advocating renewables and advancing renewables in the multifamily arena. And boy, do I love it when HUD secretaries or cabinet secretaries actually refer to the Green Building Information Gateway in their speeches. And so, as I understood this, they want us to work with them doing, and using GBIG to do it, doing what USGBC does best, which is keeping score and making sure they do what they're saying they're going to do. Now, in the middle of my talk a few minutes ago, I was asking you to join us. I was asking you to be part of a unified voice. And there were like some subliminal messages being flashed behind me with websites filling up and stuff. And I went back and people say like, what exactly do I do? How do I exactly help with this remarkable network? And so I'm going to now spell it out even more simply. You do just go to usgbc.org/troublemaker, and you do just put in the most basic information, and we then provide very simple ways for you to make a real difference. So let me just take a moment to make sure that's happening. And finally, our next speaker. Now, many of you, and you would have to be, I don't know, somewhat brain dead not to have heard of his remarkable elevation into popular culture, because what Nate Silver has done is in a way that's just delicious. He has been stripping the pundits of the left and the right, who in their grandiose way keep showing up on TV and making predictions, and also the people that show up on those economic programs and make predictions. And Nate Silver's made it quite clear that their predictions are as likely to be true as that of your drug-addled roommate in college. That nothing about the way we think about predictions makes any sense. So listen closely, take notes. People around the world are taking notes because this guy gets it right, and he does it with combination of common sense and a good deal of analytics and very thoughtful analysis. Nate Silver, ladies and gentlemen. Good luck.
Well, thank you, everybody, for joining me here today. It's an honor to speak with you all, and I also wanted to thank Secretary Clinton and Bon Jovi. They're terrific warm-up acts, and so, no, I'm just kidding. It is funny that the ultimate speechless conference is about basically applied statistics, but we'll try and conceal that fact by telling some fun stories instead. You do, in fact, hear an awful lot of hype today about data and statistics. The term big data gets thrown around a lot. If you've seen magazines, for example, the Wall Street Journal, every other ad, it seems, is for some company that wants to sell you data or give you hardware for data or consult on data, something else like that. And the idea seems to be that, well, you take all this data and you put it in a machine and press a button and it spins straw into gold. And unfortunately, that's not quite true. Big data requires big thinking, some big rethinking, and that's what today's talk is about. I do want to frame, though, the fact that people always think whenever we're living that it's the most cool, radical age ever, but we've had a long-term increase in the amount of information in the world, and there have been big paradigm shifts before as far as the ways we consume media and information. You see here, for example, the chart showing the big uptick in number of web pages that are around today. If you took all the data that's produced in a single day, so all the YouTube videos, all the newsreels, everything else, and put them on CDs like the one AOL used to send you in the mail, you would need a stack that stretched from here to Las Vegas, roughly, to accommodate all the information that was produced in just one day. So we don't have the ability to consume it all. But there have been times in the past when you've seen big increases in the availability of data as well. The most notable one is when the printing press was invented in 1440 AD. Before the printing press, it was really expensive to make a book. It cost about $25,000, in fact. You basically had to hire some dude to transcribe every character one letter at a time, and it would take maybe literally a whole year. So this made books luxury goods, and nobility might read them. It meant there weren't very many books. They might read the Bible, and maybe if they're really educated, Plato and Aristotle, but that's about it. If you have a really great idea, think about the internet now, you can transmit good and bad ideas alike for free or for very cheaply. Back then, you have a good idea, it cost $25,000 just to write it down, basically. So not a very efficient way for technology to improve. But the printing press changed that when it was invented. You see the very, very rapid spread of books produced every year. This is another way to look at the same phenomenon, where the printing press just started out in one city in Germany in 1450, and 50 years later, all throughout the continent. So even by modern standards, this was a fairly rapid period of growth. But there were also some unintended consequences of having so much new information in people's hands so rapidly. In addition to the signal, you also had a lot of noise. One thing you had in particular is people who had different religious ideas now, instead of just being able to preach in one church, weren't able to mass produce copies of their book. So there were some kooks and quacks, of course, just like in the early days of the internet, but also some very influential ideas. So the Protestant Reformation, for example, was able to spread a lot more rapidly because Martin Luther, you can produce a copy of the book for every person in every town throughout Germany, for instance. Of course, when people see things written down, and their different religious ideas in particular, they often tend to have disagreements over them. And so, as a result of people reading, you had a series of religious wars in Europe for the first 1,500 years after the printing press was invented. So the English Civil War, Spanish Inquisition, 30 Years' War, War of the Holy League, here's more wars throughout Europe, all as an unintended consequence of people having more information. And in theory, more information ought to yield more consensus. But in practice, it just yields more disagreement, especially at first, instead. In fact, this century was the bloodiest in European history until the 20th century came around and took its place. So when you know that history, that information can have unexpected and unintended consequences when you have more noise than signal, it ought to set you up to be a little bit more skeptical about some of the claims made today. This is another version of this claim made by a guy named Chris Anderson, who was in 2008 the editor of Wired magazine. And he proposes that, quote, "the end of theory, the data deluge, makes the scientific method obsolete." And what that implies is that when you have enough volume of information, when you have millions or billions or trillions of observations, lots and lots of data series, then at some point that volume conquers everything by brute force alone. You don't really need science, you don't really need expertise, any domain knowledge, really. So a lot of the people in this room, for example, might be rendered unnecessary by this theory. Fortunately, this theory is almost complete bullshit. One of the ways you can tell this is look at the time this article was written in the summer of 2008. This was a time when the entire global economy was in the midst of melting down. Models in finance is a relatively data-driven field. For example, the models that the banks used to say that mortgage-backed securities were extremely safe investments were based on millions and millions of observations about real American mortgages. The problem is you can have a lot of data, but if you sort it through a handful of faulty assumptions, they assume, for example, that housing prices in different parts of the country would be uncorrelated with one another, so you could have a housing downturn here in Philly wouldn't affect things in California. Of course, when you have a steep decline of the type you had in 2008, then that all goes awry. So lots of instruments they rate as being almost totally safe all defaulted instead. And likewise, this kind of triptych of images describes different fields in my book where there have been failures of prediction or failures of preparation. Those two things go hand in hand sometimes. For example, the earthquake, terrible earthquake that struck Japan in 2011 was a magnitude 9.0. There were some seismologists there, not all, but a sizable group, who had concluded that such an earthquake was impossible, that you could only have a magnitude 8.6 earthquake instead. And so the Fukushima reactor was only built to withstand an 8.6, despite Japan being very seismically active, and that worsened the scale of the disaster. People talk about the volume of data, and that's important, but the speed of information transmission presents a challenge as well. This is one example of that. So one day in April of this year, the Associated Press, their Twitter feed was hacked, and someone sent out a tweet that implied there had been some type of attack, perhaps a terrorist attack, on the White House. On the basis of this one tweet, the stock market lost $1.6 billion in market value in the span of a minute or two, mostly by automated trading algorithms that just read Associated Press, explosion, Obama, so no human intervention even. And then once people realized that this tweet was fake, it wasn't confirmed by the Washington Post, the New York Times, or anyone else, then the stock market recovered that gain just moments later. First of all, it's impressive how much people are willing to bet on 140 characters, making literally, how much is that per character? I'm good at math, supposedly, but it's a very big bet. But also, there are also security problems related to this type of thing. Information warfare is a term that I think is putting it too strongly, but there are a lot of vulnerabilities in this space that we might not be acutely aware of until we're going to have some big catastrophe a couple years later. Who knows? So I want to take that skeptical context and then transition a little bit to talking about my experience forecasting the election last year, which was seen in a lot of ways as a win for data and analytics. I think there was some of that, but there were also problems as well with revealing how far we have to go. If you look at the election model that I published at the New York Times last year, people sometimes describe it as being very, very complicated, but it's really pretty simple if you break it down into three major steps. And by the way, this is true of a lot of things in science. You know, the greenhouse effect, for example, is not all that complicated a reaction chemically. It's been understood for many, many years. Of course, when you have many simple things interacting together, then the Earth becomes a more complex place. But at the core, you know, sometimes pretty simple, and likewise, this model theoretically is pretty simple, where there are basically just three major steps. You see them here. Number one, average the polls. Number two, count to 270. Number three, account for the margin of error. So I'll describe each one briefly here. One of the things about seeing, reading news coverage of the campaigns is that the news media, for the most part in elections, focuses on what in some respects are the least important stories. I don't just mean, you know, trivial things like Michael Dukakis with the tank helmet on or Mitt Romney's dog on the roof. There is some of that. But I mean, when they cover polls, for example, they cover the outliers, the noise, instead of the signal. If, for example, you had 20 polls in a row come out in Pennsylvania, a state that Democrats normally win, that showed President Obama ahead, and there was a 21st poll that showed Governor Romney ahead instead, that 21st poll would probably get a lot more coverage than the first 20. Even though it's probably the outlier, you're going to have random fluctuations in polls. There are some polls that use bad data or bad methodology, but people want to create a narrative of constant fluctuation in the race. In fact, things are often pretty steady, especially in general elections. Americans, for the most part, are voting based on fundamental factors like, first of all, which party they belong to, but also the economy. Is the country going in the right direction? Are there any stupid wars going on? Big, important things, and it's the media that focuses more on the trivia to create a narrative of movement when there isn't really one. So the basic mathematical idea here is just to take an average of the polls. Again, very, very simple, but it contradicts the instinct you see in a lot of reporting. The next idea is what I call count to 270. It just means that we have an electoral college system in the U.S., so we're evaluating things in that way. If you guys have played around, if you are election geeks and you play around with those electoral maps, you color in different states blue and red, that's all that this model is doing, but just in a more comprehensive way. You know, one thing to think about is that there are different regions of the country. So, for example, Pennsylvania and Ohio have a lot of demographic similarities, or Wisconsin and Minnesota, but the principle is pretty simple. And lastly, and perhaps more importantly, is accounting for the margin of uncertainty or the margin of error, and I'll kind of keep harping back to this theme throughout this presentation. But we sometimes get credit at 538 for having called 50 out of 50 states right in 2012, but if you read the fine print on this map, like, it's not so fine because those are very large projections, but we're really thinking in terms of shades of gray or shades of probability, like a weather forecaster might, if you hear there's a 30% chance of rain, for example. So it wasn't too hard to figure out, for example, that Mitt Romney would probably win Utah or that Barack Obama would win Massachusetts, but in Florida, we had Obama with a 50.2% chance of winning, which is basically just a coin flip. We were probably unnecessarily precise. But when you take probabilities and uncertainty and try and convey it to a wider audience, then often things are lost in translation. If you tell people something is 55%, I think that means much more likely than not when it's basically even money. If you say something is 80%, they think that means almost certain. Even now people say, oh, how'd you know the whole time Obama was going to win? I said, I didn't. He was the favorite for almost all the campaign. But things could have turned another way if he'd had another couple of bad debates, if you'd had some of the problems. I mean, frankly, if you had the Obamacare rollout problems this year or last year instead of this year, I'm not sure he would have won. So contingencies could have moved it, but you got to a point toward the end where the polling was robust enough, there was no more time for news events to intervene, where you could be quite confident about that prediction overall. With that said, these relatively simple methods create a huge amount of controversy and attention, positive and negative. So this is not my humble, it's just the brag slide, basically, where it shows what happens when you go on The Daily Show and The Colbert Report, is that for like 6 hours, you can become more famous than the vice president. This is a graph of Google search traffic around my Comedy Central appearances last year. To keep things in perspective, though, the Biebs on the same scale, we're all just a warm-up act for Justin Bieber here, I think. But what is it about politics in particular that especially around election seasons makes things so contentious? Part of it kind of gets back to this problem that we had at the dawn of the printing press, where you have people who all of a sudden have much more information than they know what to do with and tend to read it and consume it very selectively. So, for example, on a typical evening, only about 5% of the people watching Fox News are Democrats. Only about 1% of the people watching MSNBC are Republicans. So it's not just that Democrats and Republicans disagree about the facts, although they do, but they're also getting entirely different sets of facts or facts depending on which network they might be watching on a given evening. I'm going to pick on one conservative-leaning website here called The Drudge Report, and this is their homepage on election morning last year. So I talked before about how an average is a pretty simple method. The thing that's even simpler than an average is just counting things. And if by the end of the election campaign last year, if you guys remember, it had been Obama had kind of a small but steady lead for most of the summer. He then had the convention where his went better than Mitt Romney's. He pulled more significantly ahead. You had the 47% day pull a little further ahead. Then you had a debate in Denver where Obama did quite poorly. Mitt Romney did very well, but came very close. But toward the end of the campaign, the last two debates were scored for Obama. You had Hurricane Sandy, an event that especially here on the East Coast allowed President Obama to look very presidential. You got the kind of Chris Christie bear hug and so forth. And so if you were just counting polls on election morning and saying, okay, I'm going to look at all the polls that have come out in the last 2 days of the campaign from swing states like Pennsylvania and Wisconsin and New Hampshire and so forth. And every time you have a poll showing Obama ahead, put it in the blue pile. Every time you have a poll showing Romney ahead, put it in the red pile. You'd wind up with a blue pile that was about 8 or 10 times larger than the red pile, just by counting things. Here, though, is what the Drudge Report had on election morning, and I've highlighted in red all the polls they've cited that implied that Romney was going to win, and in blue the ones that had good news for Obama instead. So it's literally the exact reverse of what the reality might be, and again, it shouldn't be surprising. This site is pretty partisan at times, but the thing is, people take facts about relatively simple things. I'm not saying elections are simple, but polls are pretty simple things compared to a lot of the stories that the news media deals with. A lot simpler than Obamacare, a lot simpler than stories about the environment or about the economy, and they still screw the polling part up pretty badly. And websites like these will completely spin the results in ways that are just the complete 180-degree opposite of what just an objective count might give you. So again, no surprise, but something to be aware of. There are other problems too, and by the way, the thing about having more data in that case is that it gives you more opportunities, consciously or unconsciously, to cherry pick. So it's a way in which more data, if you're not careful, can be harmful. Another issue that comes from bigger and larger volumes of data is the complexity of the relationships that we're looking at. By the way, when people talk about statistics, people think of a statistic as being something like, well, it's, you know, 48 degrees in Philadelphia today, or the Boston Red Sox hit 321 with runners in scoring position, that type of thing. There's also, though, the science of statistics, or the discipline of it, which means the science of understanding data and information and looking for relationships. So statistics is really about understanding causality. It's a very core part of science. It's not enough just to have a bunch of facts. You have to put all those facts together. But imagine you have a world in which you have relatively little data, only five variables, for example, and you're looking for relationships between the two. That means you'd have 10 permutations to check. You see, though, as you double the amount of data, the amount of complexity is rapidly increasing, not from that one-way relationship being complex in and of itself, but from the whole web of intertangling relationships that you have. You go to 10 variables, for example, now you've more than quadrupled the number of relationships that are under study. Or look at something like this, where every day the Federal Reserve publishes in real time 148,000 economic statistics. That means relationships between any two of them, say the unemployment rate in Pennsylvania and potato production in Idaho, there are now 10.9 billion combinations of these to check. And believe me, there are some real pearls of wisdom sitting in there somewhere, but there are also a lot of false positives, of chance circumstances that appear as signal when they're really just noise. One infamous one involves a relationship between the stock market and the Super Bowl, where for many years there had been a streak where the team, if the NFC team, say the Eagles, won the Super Bowl, the stock market would have a good year. If the AFC team, say the Patriots, won instead, it would have a bad year instead. And then finally, in 2008, you had one of the most memorable Super Bowls of all time, the New York Giants. The NFC team came from behind and defeated the New England Patriots, so it should have been a really good omen for the stock market. But of course, instead, the stock market had the worst year since the Great Depression. If you're betting on a correlation that doesn't have any real rationale, any root cause behind it, then I'd be happy to take the other side of that bet. Unstructured data will produce lots of these just because of, this is the downside of having a 10.9 billion volumes of data to look at. You'll catch a lot of positives, false positives if you don't apply some science to double check things. Again, another couple of ways to present the same basic idea here, where I'm not saying that information is literally useless. I think it is, in fact, quite useful having more data. You have more signals as you increase the number of variables, but the number of false correlations can increase more rapidly, and being human beings, that gives us the potential for being very hubristic about what we do with data. The gap between what we really know and what we think we know may be widening in some ways. One more take on this, marginally more technical, but gets at the same basic concept here, where, so imagine that we're looking for true hypotheses. We're looking for real causal, fundamental underlying factors here. Our true signals, our needles in the haystack, they're represented in red here, and the 100 circles in black instead are the false positives, just the noise instead. So I'm asserting here that we're in an environment which is not terribly signal rich. There are some, but they're surrounded by a lot of others. But we're smart people. We apply some filters. We have some common sense. So, for example, let's say we correctly block 80% of the false positives, so only 20% get through. And likewise, our process, our algorithm, captures 80% of the true signals. So it seems like we've made a lot of progress, and to be sure, we have. But still, when you recombine these, you have more noise than signal. Because you started out with so few signals in this vast array of data, you still have a problematic result. And by the way, these numbers might seem arbitrary, but they come up in a couple of cases. One of them is in research in medicine, where there are now lots of laboratories around the world testing lots of drug interactions every day, for example, performing thousands of experiments. But they're very selective in which results get reported to medical journals and so forth. So what happens if you read even the most prestigious medical journals, you have an experiment described by scientists at Harvard or Johns Hopkins or what have you. When people try and recreate that experiment, they fail more than half the time, even in the best medical journals, because you have such high potential for false positives in this environment where you have so much unstructured data. And there's a lot that goes into it, but this is really a very problematic area for science in a lot of ways. You know, one of the things we hope to do at my site 538, we're going from just being a politics site to now covering areas including economics, including science and science policy. But we hope to, you know, in some ways take a less skeptical eye toward kind of big S science, but a more skeptical eye toward individual studies that sometimes get blown out in the press and have results that are good, too good to be true. And understanding that consensus in science is a process that requires a lot of going back and forth. If you apply this process you see here a few more times and you really do strain down the noise and you finally get some very useful signals as a result, but it takes multiple iterations. It takes sometimes a community of people working together, having debates, having arguments, but there has to be arguments in good faith where everyone has the same goal of finding the truth. We don't necessarily have that in the political arena as much as in the scientific one sometimes. Part of the issue, too, is that as human beings, our brains are very hyperactive and wired to detect signals. I live in New York, and every time, for example, the Yankees have a three-game losing streak, it's like an existential crisis in the New York Post, when it's just usually random noise instead to a first approximation. You see it in stock market data, for instance, where every time there's the slightest tick of the stock market, there's some pundit going on CNBC trying to explain the deep implications of this. There's a book I like called A Random Walk Down Wall Street, which is written by a Princeton professor named Burton Malkiel. He describes an experiment that we would sometimes have his students do where they would take a few minutes class and they would all flip coins and generate just a random series of heads and tails. Then they would draw fake stock market charts. Every time you had a head, you'd have a uptick in the market or a downtick for tails. And take these charts, or just fake data, like most of these, and show them to Wall Street analysts who would have very firm recommendations about entirely fake stocks. They'd say, buy this one immediately. No, sell this one. It's a dog. But just trading off the noise, literally. By the way, D and F are actually the real charts here. If you got that right, you're in the wrong conference, I think. It might seem that if we human beings are so prone toward biases when we work with big and large data sets, that why not just automate everything instead? Why not turn things over to the machines, so to speak? But this is very problematic as well, and I'll kind of explain by means of a metaphor here. So as I'll talk about a little bit later, I'm not really a chess player. I'm more of a poker player instead. I, for some reason, enjoy games that involve some element of randomness. But if you are a chess player, you might have a view on this position here, which is from the 1997 match between man and machine. So Garry Kasparov, the great Russian chess champion, maybe the best chess player of all time, he has the white pieces, the human being, an IBM supercomputer, Deep Blue, the Watson, I guess, of its time, is playing the black pieces instead. What's interesting, and again, you see the same theme here, is just like in politics and just like in the area of the printing press, people are looking at the same data and coming to vastly different conclusions about it based on what they're focusing on. So first of all, this is how Deep Blue might evaluate this complex position here. What it will tend to do, a computer, is it uses an algorithm and breaks that position down into individual components. So it'll say, for example, we can find a way to give a score to each piece we have on the board. And, for example, the computer believes a knight's worth about three times as much as a pawn, or a queen's worth nine times as much. So it scores itself and says, I have 30 points worth of material. Kasparov has 29. You know, this guy's not so good. You know, I'm probably going to win, it would think, if it thought. Kasparov, looking at the same position, much less raw computing power than Deep Blue. It would literally take him his whole lifetime to make all the calculations that Deep Blue does in the span of a handful of moves in this match, but his thinking is much more directed. Here's where his pattern recognition skills quite help him, in fact. So what Kasparov sees is that Deep Blue has lost sight of the bigger picture. The goal in chess is not to accumulate the most material, not to get all the nice, shiny objects, but the goal is to outlast your opponent. The goal is to make sure that you checkmate your opponent before you get checkmated yourself, and Deep Blue has neglected that problem. Instead, Kasparov has three pawns that are moving essentially unguarded toward Deep Blue's vulnerable king. He has a bishop and a queen targeted on the same blind spot. So, in fact, Deep Blue is in deep shit in this position, it turns out. And it would go on to lose, but not without a final twist, where one good thing about computers, they don't get tired, they don't go on strike, don't get hungry. They keep fighting on and keep executing the program. It might not be a good program, but they keep doing it over and over again until you tell them to stop. And so Deep Blue would play out this match almost toward the bitter end when a human being might have resigned, recognizing that it had an inferior position. But it made a very strange move toward the very end of the match here, where it moved its rook down the d-file, so from d5 to d1. Again, I'm not much of a chess player, but even I can tell that this move doesn't really accomplish anything whatsoever. It just seems kind of random, kind of like it's wasting a turn. And in fact, Deep Blue would go ahead and lose just a couple of moves later. But Kasparov went back after the match, and chess players think everything through, review their performances, and he was disturbed by this move because he didn't understand why Deep Blue made it. He couldn't see any rationale for it at all at first. But then he said, well, look, I'm Garry Kasparov, and I can think sometimes 15 moves into the future, 15 moves ahead, more than any other human being alive. And I don't understand why Deep Blue made this play. So he inferred that meant that Deep Blue could therefore see an horizon beyond him, go 16 or 17 or 20 moves ahead instead, and became very intimidated after this, would never in fact beat Deep Blue again. He would lose the six-game series. It turns out, though, that in researching my book, I went and talked to one of Deep Blue's programmers, a guy named Murray Campbell, who's still at IBM today. And what he told me is that what looked at first like a random bug was in fact a random bug in Deep Blue's code. Again, terrific computer program. Will be in the Computer Program Hall of Fame, I think, Deep Blue, and it did go on to beat Kasparov. But, you know, thousands and thousands of lines of code put together quite quickly. He had lost to Kasparov in 96. You had this rematch now in 97. And there are a few glitches here and there. Smartly, though, Deep Blue's programmers had a fail-safe routine where if you're hitting like an endless loop of code in chess, you're on a clock in competitive chess, so you'd time out and forfeit if you don't make any move at all. So after X seconds, it would make a random legal chess move ahead to avoid forfeiting automatically. That's what it did. It made a random legal chess move. In fact, one of the very worst moves you could make in that position. But it kept Kasparov and Deep Blue playing, and Kasparov mistook it for a sign of profound genius instead. So this issue we've been harping on, but it's important. Feature or bug? You have a novel result from the data, a very exciting result, and believe me, the second half of this presentation, or the second, or the last third, we'll talk somewhat more optimistically about areas where progress is being made, but one more example of this feature or bug issue. So as I mentioned, I live in New York, in Manhattan, in fact, what the real estate brochures optimistically call North Chelsea on 30th Street and 7th Avenue, was giving another talk at the Guggenheim Museum, which is on 89th and 5th Avenue, a few months ago. And so one thing about New York, very rapid pace of life, complicated in some ways, but getting from point A to point B should be pretty simple in Manhattan. All the streets are a grid, they're all numbered sequentially, so what could go wrong? That's the route that Google Maps would recommend. By contrast, this is the route that my taxi driver decided to take that day. So we make three crossings of Central Park, make a loop-de-loop at 72nd Street, and finally arrive 45 minutes late at the Guggenheim. So why did this guy take this route? It turns out this is exactly what the GPS recommended. No joke. I was watching him carefully. He was an honest guy, and this is the GPS recommended route. I figured out later on the reason why is that there's a road that cuts north to south through Central Park called East Drive, which the GPS thought was a shortcut. It is a real road. It's a little bit twisty and windy. It's kind of pretty. It's like where a lot of people get like murdered on like Law and Order and stuff like that. And the GPS said you should really take this route, driver, because there's no traffic at all on the road today. As you guys might have inferred, the reason was there was no traffic is because it was closed for repairs that day. I'm not sure why. Maybe a Law and Order filming, for all I know. But what it thought was a feature it was exploiting was instead just a case of adverse selection. Taking the noise that common sense would override and mistaking it for signal instead. People, by the way, talk a lot about the role of kind of gut instinct versus metrics or analytics. A lot of people, when they have a discussion, tend to what I call lead with their gut. So basically, they'll have some gut reaction to something, and they'll come up with the data later on to justify their gut. I think the better way to do it sometimes is to have lead with the data and then have a gut check at the end. You try and be as analytic as possible, but here, for example, the text grabber should have overridden the data with his common sense, which basically says that you never cross Central Park twice on the same journey unless you see Godzilla on the Chrysler Building. So moving from diagnosing the problem and explaining at some length now why big data is not a panacea and why we need science and why we need theory, why we need people to work really hard on this stuff, toward not solutions but suggestions for a better approach, toward types of thinking that across a broad array of fields. Again, I'm not coming here and pretending to be an expert in green building or green design. I'm talking about things that in the course of my research and my work have proven to have some universality to them. This is the one mathematical formula I'll show you today, the one and only. It's a sign depicting Bayes' theorem. Bayes' theorem is a formula that's a couple hundred years old. It was invented, I think, in the 18th century. And it's a very simple algebraic formula that describes how you incorporate new information, new data, into your pre-existing worldview. So in Bayes' theorem, you start out with what's called a prior belief, meaning you do have some set of assumptions you make about a problem, you make about the world. You do begin with some knowledge. It may be right or it may be wrong. Bayes' theorem provides a way to correct yourself over time, but it's just saying that we all start out with a point of view somewhere looking out on the world, framed in Bayes' theorem in the form of a probability. And then in Bayes' theorem, you're running experiments constantly. It's very scientific in a sense, and you gather new data, and you update your beliefs, and they become more accurate in what's called a posterior belief instead. And then when you're done, you say, well, I had a theory, for example, about how likely climate change, global warming was to occur. I evaluate some data. Does that make it more likely or less likely? You now have a better revised belief, and you keep processing as new data comes along. So in some ways, very intuitive, but it requires a lot of discipline to apply in practice. One problem, for example, in a lot of news organizations say, well, we're being completely objective here, when they're really making tons and tons of assumptions that underlie their beliefs. But I'll explain all these things in a moment here. So there are three kind of key themes that stem out of Bayes' theorem. Think probabilistically, know where you're coming from, and try and error. Let me explain each one here. So instead of an ugly PowerPoint slide, imagine that you're looking at a beautiful river in North Dakota. In particular, the Red River of the North, which is interesting from a climate point of view because every year what happens, of course, is cold up there in North Dakota. In the spring, you have a lot of melt from the snowfall, and if the snow melts too quickly and there's too much of it, then you have the risk of flooding in the streams and rivers up there. So one year in 1997, there had been an especially heavy accumulation of snow up in North Dakota. The Weather Service was especially concerned, therefore, about flooding. And they issued a prediction saying that the Red River of the North would crest on the worst day at 49 feet. People in Grand Forks, North Dakota, though, the largest town on the Red River, had flood walls that went up to 51 feet instead. So they were mildly worried, but almost nobody bought insurance. After all, the Weather Service had predicted a 49-foot crest, and they had 51 feet of protection. Of course, what the Weather Service didn't convey to the people of Grand Forks, North Dakota, was what the margin of error on their forecast was, plus or minus 9 feet. They were afraid that if they conveyed uncertainty in the outlook, that people there wouldn't trust the forecast. It would undermine their credibility. In fact, the water's crested at 53 feet, so it's actually a pretty good forecast in a way, you know, only about 8% off, even though this was made several weeks in advance, but that was enough for the water to overflow the levee, and almost all the town was flooded. This was a slow-moving disaster. People got out with their lives, fortunately, but you had millions, or billions, rather, of dollars in uninsured property losses, losses that should have been insured if the forecasts were explained more thoroughly, and you needed a big federal and state bailout as a result. I don't mean to pick on the Weather Service. It's, in fact, they are now among the very best organizations at conveying uncertainty in the outlook. You see, for example, here their track of Hurricane Sandy last year. So you notice here a couple things. First of all, the visual display of information where you see as you move out in time and space, uncertainty expands. This is one of the most basic principles in any type of predictive analytics, predictive science, where you can look really smart on election day when there's no more time for news events to intervene, when you have hundreds and hundreds of polls, when increasingly in this country a lot of people have already voted. We have a lot of early voting. About a third of the vote now is cast before election day. So by kind of pointing to the obvious on election day, you get way too much credit. Conversely, it's very, very hard to make predictions more than really 6 months to a year out when it comes to politics. So if you ask me now who's going to win in 2016, I'd say, well, I have no idea, really, to a first approximation. And that's the reality of the same thing with weather forecasting. As good as weather forecasts have gotten now, you see for Hurricane Sandy, they nailed the forecasts, in fact, 5 days in advance, almost the exact county in New Jersey where the storm would hit. But long-term weather forecasts are problematic. You see here, by the way, all the progress that weather forecasters have made over time. So it used to be that kind of weatherman, the meteorologist, was a butt of jokes. And in fact, 25 years ago, there was some justification for it. 25 years ago, if you had a hurricane sitting in the Gulf of Mexico 3 days before landfall, their forecast would miss by an average of 350 miles, which means that half the time it would be somewhere between Houston and Tallahassee. The other half, God knows where, maybe here in Philadelphia or something, or Mexico or Guam, I don't know. But now they miss by only about 100 miles instead. In fact, the past couple of hurricane seasons, I think they're at an 80-mile miss on average, 3 days in advance, as you saw for Hurricane Sandy, so much more accurate than they had before. Ironically, part of the reason why the forecasts have achieved this is because they learned early on that their forecasts were never going to be perfect. Weather forecasters literally create models of the Earth's atmosphere. As computer power gets better, they break these into smaller and smaller grids. So they're using actual science. They understand the chemical reactions. They're not complex mathematically. It just becomes a problem of trying to get a finer and finer grid. But you're never going to be able to get down to the individual molecule or atomic level. So they have to make, there's some intrinsic uncertainty in that problem. Some approximations they have to make because we have imperfect powers of observation. But having realized that very early on in meteorology, chaos theory, if you heard a butterfly flaps its wings in Beijing, you have a tornado in Texas, that comes out of actually frustrated early attempts to predict the weather, literally. Because they realized that early on, they've been used thinking in terms of probabilities instead. So you do have the 40% chance of rain or an area where a tornado or a hurricane might hit, an area of more vulnerability. And they've made more progress by being less sure of themselves, in essence, but also by having a lot of science that weather forecasting is not purely just a statistical model. It's based on making good assumptions that are rooted in science, and that combination of big data and good technology and big theory produces a lot of progress on a very human scale in the industry. If you have just one of those, you might not get very far, however. Idea number two, I started talking about this a little bit before. I call it know where you're coming from. People sometimes use terms like objective and subjective. So, for example, in journalism, people say, well, if I quote from both sides equally, then I'm being objective. My view is that no individual human being is actually objective, because objective means the part outside of you, apart from this kind of collective world that we all share together. We all approach the world with a subjective point of view, and by having conversations, by conducting science, by making predictions, that's how we test and see how much our subjective view actually matches reality, maybe more so for some people than others. But this slide's another kind of metaphor that helps to get at this principle and helps to get the idea of how what can happen in a world of big data when we're sometimes defined by our weakest link. This is a map showing the route the Japanese aircraft carrier task force took in 1941 before conducting what we thought of as, at the time, as a sneak attack on Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, which ushered America's involvement into World War II. What's interesting is that even though at the time this attack was considered as surprising as September 11th would be 60 years later, you look back on it now with benefit of hindsight and it seems kind of obvious. For one thing, we decided to stack almost our entire Pacific fleet in one harbor in Hawaii, so not a very good way to diversify our risks. Ironically, we were worried back then about domestic terrorism. We thought there were a lot of Japanese nationals in Hawaii who might sabotage the ships and put them all out in Pearl Harbor where everyone can see them. And you solve that problem, but you create a vulnerability from an attack coming from abroad. But we also were complacent about our signal detection capabilities, where this was before the era of global satellites. Instead, we had a handful of naval bases in the Pacific, where we had reconnaissance missions. Planes would go out and observe things for a radius of a few hundred miles out in each direction. But we didn't have comprehensive coverage whatsoever at all. And so what Japan does is say, well, here are exactly where these guys have no ability to detect us, and then they take that exact route. If you guys have read the Michael Lewis book, The Blind Side, this is kind of the same idea here, where you might have a very good quarterback in football. You might have a very good running back. If you have a leaky offensive line, a left tackle that is going to allow the quarterback to get sacked, the play to be broken up behind the line of scrimmage, then all your other defenses go for naught. So even though America was much more powerful than Japan overall, or at least a little bit more powerful, the Imperial Navy wasn't nothing, you see the vulnerability we create by arrogance, in essence, about how good our defenses were. So this idea here about kind of admitting to our weaknesses or being alert to them, how much they can actually help us be more accurate. I'll give you one more example here, which is adapted from the book Lean In by the Facebook COO, Sheryl Sandberg. It's a book about the problems women have in the workforce, discrimination against women, and it describes some experiments from social science. In one case, for example, I think this was done among police and fire chiefs. They were given two sets of resumes that had identical credentials, but the gender of the name was changed. So instead of having, you know, you had Jane instead of John, or Marvin and Marsha, or Nate and Natalie, or whatever. And of course, in some of these occupations, as in the tech space sometimes, women can be discriminated against, not being offered an interview or a job despite having exactly the same credentials. The twist, though, in this experiment is that the people who thought they had no gender bias whatsoever were actually more likely to make this error. The guys who said, I would never think about gender in hiring, would never affect my decision. They actually were more likely to not call back the equally qualified women than the ones who said, you know what, gender does affect my perceptions about job candidates. I kind of have to actively think about that and maybe counteract it when I'm making my choices. So if you ever hear someone saying that they're being totally objective, then that probably means that they're biased in ways they're not even aware of instead. Idea number three here, I'll close with a relatively fun anecdote about poker. So this guy here is a guy named Chris Moneymaker, who was indirectly responsible for me making and then losing a lot of money. So Chris Moneymaker, I should say, before I started my blog, 538, I'd written about baseball. Before that, I had a consulting job out of college at an accounting firm named KPMG, and it was a pretty boring job, really. This guy, Chris Moneymaker, had a job like mine. He was an accountant, I think, for Deloitte down in Nashville. But this is an era in which online poker was becoming bigger. So this kind of 30-something, like balding accountant deposits money in an online poker site, wins a $20 qualifying tournament, then enters the real World Series of Poker in Las Vegas, Nevada, a 10,000 entry fee, which he's won, and won that too, then won a $2 million first prize in Las Vegas, defeating all the pros along the way. So it's not quite a rags to riches story. It's like a mid-level consultant to riches story. But still, by the standards of poker, it makes for pretty good TV. The guy's name is Moneymaker. He is an amateur defeating all these pros. You see here a famous hand that he played against this old pro named Sam Farha, where Moneymaker made a big bluff. He didn't have anything here. And Sam Farha folds top pair, folds what was the best hand head-to-head here. And you watch this on TV where you get to see in real time what Sam Farha's cards are, and you think, boy, this guy's an idiot. I can be the next Chris Moneymaker, right? Of course, you go to a real casino and you have x-ray vision like they have on TV, they'll show you a very interesting back room in that casino where you might not escape from with all your limbs attached necessarily. But anyway, people watch poker on TV. It was a big deal all over ESPN, and a lot of people thought they were much better at poker than they were, and I, being not great at poker, but pretty good for the time, was able to take some of their money as a result. But this was all in the name of science. So while doing this, I was also doing data mining on different online poker sites and collected data that speaks to how much different players at the table were making or losing over the long run. So this is a typical 10-person table, long run win rate. So this is removing the luck. There's a lot of luck in the near term, but how much we think people would make per hour or lose per hour if they're playing until infinity. One thing you notice here is that it's really a lot easier to be really bad at something than really good at something. The best player at the table makes about $110 an hour, so not bad. The worst player, though, loses $425 an hour instead. In fact, if he just folded every hand, didn't even try, he would only lose $200 an hour instead. So by trying, he's making things much worse. This is a way to introduce what is maybe the most boring PowerPoint slide, engineering slide in history. It's a learning curve, or an 80-20 curve, which shows the learning process that occurs when working usually with large and complex informational problems, of which poker, by the way, is one. So typically, by getting just a few basic things right, you get a lot of the way toward what a more complex solution might give you. So for example, in poker, if you just use the rule set, well, you know, raise or bet with your good hands, call with your kind of good hands, and fold your bad hands, that'll give you the right answer 80% of the time. It's not a very subtle strategy, there's no bluffing involved and so forth, but you're probably making the same decision that a poker pro would 80% of the time. It can prevent you from losing as much money as that guy before was. That first 20%. So another example from baseball, if you guys have read another Michael Lewis book, Moneyball, talks about Billy Bean and the Oakland A's. A lot of their success was because they realized that teams were undervaluing on-base percentage relative to batting average. They weren't giving guys enough credit for drawing walks, even though that helps set the offense up, put runners on base, score more runs, win more games, and everyone's happy. But you see here when Billy Bean, the hero of the book, takes over for the A's in 1998, there's a big spike in how many walks they're drawing relative to the league average, and then it compresses toward the median over time. So what happens over time, one of the good things about a free market economy is that if there's a void, someone comes along to fill it when there's an opportunity, for better or for worse. So to go back to the poker example here, imagine that there's a water level in the industry. So you see here, you have what's kind of a trickle-up economy. This one really bad poker player, we call them fish in poker, is providing a subsistence existence for this middle class of poker players. But eventually this guy, you know, eventually his wife's going to divorce him or something, or he runs out of money, or he gets better, actually. And so he busts out. And what happens? Well, all these players that were above water before begin to sink instead. So thinking about where is the water level in different problems that you're solving, if you're working in a field where people haven't been very data-driven at all, like politics, then you don't have to make things overly complicated. Just usually focusing on the basics and looking for the cultural constraints or the disincentives that create people, that stop people from doing the big kind of obvious things, the things like in politics, just kind of pointing and taking the polling average, for example. But over time, when you get fields that are more competitive, then things become much harder. People look at this as a negative, where you can put in a lot of work and only make modest gains. But that's where your competitive advantage often comes from, in fields like technology is making improvements continuously, one step at a time, and having lots of little wins instead of having some miracle occur instead. So think about a company like Google, for example, a company we think of as being very proficient with big data, one of the most admired companies in the world. So what's the big idea behind Google? I would contend that there really isn't one big idea. And so there's a culture of testing and refining lots of little ideas, creative little ideas over time. If you run a Google search today and run the same search in a week or so, you'll probably notice you don't get the same results. Not just because new links come up in the news, but also because they are constantly changing and refining their algorithms, performing thousands of experiments in real time every day. And this is part of the Bayesian process. You start out with some assumption, you start with some idea. It's great, looks great in theory, and it turns out, not to work so well in practice. The reverse can be true as well. If you had described Twitter, for example, when it was first invented, you'd be like, that's kind of a stupid idea. What do we need that thing for? Now the company has a multi-billion dollar valuation as a result. Testing your ideas in the real world through trial and error, if you are in a big data environment, is the best way to improve. I kind of summarize it by this quote, which is from Piet Hein, a Danish scientist and author, and it's talking about being process-oriented and not results-oriented. This is part of science, that science never has a starting point and an end point. It's improving continuously instead. You have to kind of love the quest to gain more knowledge. And the way he puts it, and the way I'll conclude my presentation for you, he says, the road to wisdom, well, it's plain and simple to express. Error and error and error again, but less and less and less. So thank you guys very much.
All right. Okay, I was right. Nate Silver is absolutely spectacular, and I'm so glad you all got a chance to hear him. Nate Silver is spectacular. Sean Donovan did a wonderful job of explaining what the administration is doing, more so than any HUD secretary in history. He gets it. But the thing that really warmed my heart was the fact that we had a 200% increase in our troublemaker network right during this closing plenary. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce the heart and the soul. Yes, pause to hear her. The heart and the soul of the U.S. Green Building Council and Greenbuild, and the troublemaker lioness mashup off the charts person, Kimberly Lewis.
Good afternoon, Greenbuild. Alas, Greenbuild Nation and the USGBC 20th anniversary celebration is coming to an end here in Philadelphia, and we did it big. As my colleague Roger Platt stated, we are all in this movement together. We are stronger. We are bolder, unified, so join us. We would like to thank the Executive Director of the Delaware Valley Green Building Council, Janet Milkman, and the Chair of the Delaware Valley Green Building Council, Abby O'Brien. And to the Chair of the Greenbuild Nation Host Committee, Joe Healy. Where are you, Joe? You tirelessly worked to lead our volunteer effort throughout this road to Greenbuild Nation in Philadelphia. And to all of the staff of DVGBC, Heather, the work that you did to work with our teams, we are so very blessed for your heart, your soul, and we thank you. The City of Brotherly Love has truly spread their love to Greenbuild. Please help me welcome to the stage the amazing lioness who makes all of this happen, Kate Hurst, the director of Greenbuild Conference. Please stand. Yes. Not only have we been partners in this journey for 10 years, we coordinated well. And a heartfelt shout out to the USGBC Greenbuild team and the extended USGBC staff. We did it. Well, the road to Greenbuild is shifting south, and we hear the musical sounds of leadership jazz as we pass the Greenbuild torch to the executive director of the Louisiana chapter of USGBC, Shannon Stage, and all of the volunteers of the South Central. See you in New Orleans.